Hey, y'all. I say, hey, y'all. If y'all could do me a favor, they got me in this big old room with these lights. If y'all could scoot up, I ain't gonna bite you. Thank you, I appreciate it. If the Lord so ever obliges you to do so. Happy Friday. Happy Friday. Every day is a good day. Above ground, yes. All right, how y'all doing? How's the summit been going so far?
Awesome.
Y'all been learning a lot? Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Ooh, this bright, y'all. They got me. I had a mind to take my shoes off and just, you know. I like conversations. I like getting with my folks. Get comfortable. Don't tempt me. Because I ain't see the booth out there for my wine. I was going to get real comfortable. But thank you all. I know I'm probably standing in between y'all getting home on Friday, kicking your shoes off, beating this. St. Louis got fake traffic. I said it all the time. The fake traffic headed back home. But I thank you all for coming to see Little Old Me and watching my film. Thank you so much. Thank you. But today I want to talk a little bit about the art of story. I know on the brochure you know, has a little formal academic title of the wonderful exploration of document. I'm talking about story and the power of narrative and how it can be harmful, but also how it can be pleasant. And then we're gonna get into a little bit of conversation if that's all right with you. Okay, so if you feel safe, if you feel comfortable, I would like everybody that in your seats to close your eyes, okay? Close your eyes and I want you to imagine or think up a person, a place, or a thing that you hold dear to you. It could be something as cliche as your favorite teddy bear, it could be your first car, whatever you hold dear to you, right? I want you to remember maybe your most recent memory or the most positive memory with the person, place, or thing that you hold dear. Who else was there? How old were you? What you had on? What the room smelled like? And to sit in that space. Okay. Now I want you to imagine that some place, something, someone that you hold dear gets abruptly taken away from you by no fault of your own, but it is taken away. Okay. Whatever emotions or thoughts or feelings that evoked in you with that, I want you to sit with that, right? That's going to kind of lead into the conversation. So I want you to sit with that. So, in sitting with that, on a brighter note, my name is Alana Marie. I am a Dallas-based, but St. Louis-bred through and through. I'm St. Louis through and through. Digital content creator, photographer, documentary filmmaker, social media manager. I've been here all of my life. I'm no longer living here. I spent the first 30 years of my life in St. Louis. I now live in Dallas. I am a mom. I have a 14-year-old. I know y'all looking at me like, 14? Mind your business. I'm a 14-year-old, and I have a 9-month-old. Y'all ain't praying hard enough for me. You're not praying hard enough for me. Yes, I started over. And I'm a wife. I have an amazing husband who was another creative and storyteller. I've been married for 5 years this year. And so thank you, thank you, thank you. They say the first 7 is the hardest. We almost there. I have an MSW. I studied at the Brown School of Social Work and got my master's in social work in 2017, emphasis in social and economic development under the tutelage of the amazing Jack Kirkland. Love him, appreciate him for all he has done. So that's a lot of the work that I have done up to this point. And so I've always identified as a storyteller. And so now I'm in a place of, I don't know what it is about your 30s that I feel like I'm in a midlife crisis. Like I'm trying to figure out what it is that I want to continue to do, join the workforce, did all of these things, got laid off, got another job, got laid off again, getting it back into the artistry, but I've always been a storyteller. I remember I used to be 11 years old watching Lifetime on Sundays. Like, I'm really about 76 in a 33-year-old body. I always enjoyed stories. I used to write music. My dad is a singer you saw in the film. If you watched it, that's my father. My mom is an archivist, not by trade, but that's where I get that from. My younger brother is a rapper. My older brother is an artist. So I come from that. But I make sense of the world through stories. And one story that stuck out to me, now that I think back into trying to figure out what I want to do, I'm just really reconnecting with childhood Alana. Before capitalism came into play. But a story that sticks out for me, I remember I was a junior in high school, so this had to be 2007, and I remember reading in the newspaper and also seeing on the news, if I get my details correctly, it was a young boy. He had to be about 11 years old, and he was charged and he was sentenced to 60 years in prison. So he had to serve up until he was 18 in juvenile, and then he would serve in adult prison for sexually assaulting and sodomizing a 6-year-old girl. And I remember reading this story like, yes, that is horrible, but he's 11. And so that's, for many people, where the story like just started. He did this horrible act and then he's about to spend the rest of his life in prison. And I just remember being so bothered by that, like, why is that the resolve? Like, why are not both of these children seeking or getting care? Like, that was wrong, but he's getting that from somewhere. And so that story always stuck with me because that's how I made sense of the world and how the media shaped these narratives, especially among, he was a young black boy and the young girl was a young white girl. But I've always been stuck with stories. And so I want to talk a little bit about narrative paradigms. So it's a theory that suggests that human beings are natural storytellers and that a good story is more convincing than a good argument. Hold on to that as we lean more into narrative and how the media shapes our narrative and the things that we hold on to, even the things that have been proven to be not true, but because it makes for a good story. Hold on to that as well. So a couple of questions that you all, and this is the frame that I'm using. So stories and narratives, why is this important? Because narratives, it drives our thoughts, which thus drives our beliefs, which thus drives our behaviors, which then drives our actions. And depending on where you are, on which side of the coin that is, that can either be very beautiful, or as we are seeing in real time, very dangerous. So with the Kinlock doc, I've told this story a lot, how I even got into doing this film and creating a film, because again, I'm a first-time filmmaker. I did not go to school for film. Like I said, I got a master's in social work and I'm out here trying to be Ava DuVernay. But I remember being at the Brown School and I'm under Jack Kirkland, who's an amazing professor, and I'm 25 at the time. And I'm just learning about these parts of St. Louis that I never seen. Like, my mom was raised in Pruitt-Igoe before it shut down. I didn't see it. I didn't know anything about it. I never saw the site of where Pruitt-Igoe used to be until I went to the Brown School. Never heard of Meacham Park until I went to the Brown School. Never heard of Mill Creek Valley until I went to the Brown School. Mind you, I am 25. So I'm spending a large part of my time at the Brown School pissed off because I felt like all of the years that I spent in school prior to, not necessarily lied to, but just information that I felt like I should know as a St. Louisan was withheld from me. And I had to spend, y'all know how much the Brown School is, a year just to learn information that should be free, right? And so he took us to East St. Louis. We spent the week in East St. Louis. And the first day of class, it was systemic racism in East St. Louis was a course. We took a bus tour through all of those historic black areas, some of which are no longer here, as you know, and some of which are still here. So we're driving, we go stop at Kinlock, and I'm like, my family's from here, but by the time I was born, there was no, as you saw in the film, there was no reason to go back there. So I only know what my family has kind of told me up until this point. In my 20s, I didn't really care to know, but now that I'm in the space that I just care to know about black history and just where my family's come from and just the origin of St. Louis and how policies impacted communities of color, I started doing more research. And so at this time, if you also saw the film either yesterday or today, at the very end of the film, you saw the In Memory collage during this time. That is all of my family on my father's side of the family. Those are all my father's siblings. My father's the last surviving sibling. of all of the siblings that he was raised with. He has one half-brother left that lives in Atlanta and his parents. So during this time, prior to making the film, even through making the film, these are all of the people that have passed away that lived in Kinlock. So for me, personal note, it was me figuring out, you know, reconciling with my grief and connecting with, you know, my grief and learning about family members that, from other people's lens, right? So that's on the personal note. But the story up until this point, it's my amazing grandmother, has been, okay, this Kinlock was a place that black people lived. It was the largest all-black community in the country during its prime. And then all of a sudden, they shut down the schools, and then these kids had to go to Ferguson, Florissant at the time, which was predominantly white. And then shortly after that, the airport came and bought all this land, and then that's how it looks. I'm like, okay, that, yes, but like, what happened in here, right? And what happened in here? Like, what happened? So I got inquisitive. I started asking questions. Like, I really wanted to know, how does a place like the stories that you heard in the film that had a mom and pop shop, and they had the YMCA and the library and the school districts and the teachers that lived down the street from you, they had everything, what they say, but a bank. How did it get to be how it looks right now? Started asking questions. So I started sitting down and talking to people. I literally, so this was in, that's my father, informational interviews. One thing that I learned being in the social work school, how social work and filmmaking tie in together, before I ever broke a camera out, I just talked to people, right? I just talked to people and just got them comfortable. Because as we know, with the media, and I identified as somebody in the media in making this film, if you were to Google or Wikipedia the city of Kinlock right now, all negative, all negative. Anytime Kinlock pops up on your news feed, it's somebody going to jail or a body has been found in the city. All negative. And so I wanted to ease that tension and come in and make my intentions known, however long that took. So I started doing informational interviews in like August of 2015. I didn't break out a camera until April of 2016 because I wanted to build that trust. That was very important to me, regardless of the fact that my kinfolk was from there. So I had some people to vouch for me, right? But they don't know Alana. They don't know me, right? They don't know this girl from WashU and WashU's relationship to the city of Kinlock, right? So I just started asking questions, like, what was your experience there? What was this like for you? When this happened, how did it make you feel? Started asking more questions, and then I would ask them to connect me to other people. And not necessarily other people that had their same viewpoint, right? Because that was also important to me. Regardless, I have a bias coming into this film, clearly, because my family is from there, but I wanted to know from all viewpoints. I wanted to know all the narratives. Continue the amazing John Wright. To talk to people and ask questions to kind of shape this story. So I'm doing research and I'm at the Missouri History Museum and I'm pulling those stories together and I'm at the Mercantile Library at Umsol and I'm pulling those stories together and I'm pairing them with what people are telling me and I'm spending so much time just immersed in research and just learning truly how, from what I've been told over the time from my family, from what I'm seeing online, from the articles that I'm reading to the newscasts, that all I've learned about Kinlock up until this point, right? And one thing that stuck out to me, I was like, the narration and where people start the story and the source truly matters. So it wasn't just the fact that they closed the school district. The reason they closed the school district, the courts deemed it unconstitutional that the Kinlock school district was all black. But how did it get to be all black, right? So in the process of the city of Kinlock getting incorporated in 1948, because at the time it was not incorporated, the city of Berkeley was not created. Kinlock was primarily white at the time. So what happens? The first black family buys their house, and then what happens after that? We just come on, move it along too. If they're here, it's clearly okay for me to be here too, right? And so what also happens? White flight. It's the narrative that because you live here now, I'm not supposed to live here because you have now lessened the value of my home. So I'm gonna leave. Me being next to you, the narrative that I have is that now you are a threat, right? So they're leaving. What do? They create the city of Berkeley. That is how Berkeley came to be. It's weird to see it now that Berkeley was all white. It looks nothing like that now, but that is the only reason the city of Berkeley was created, because they didn't wanna be next to these black folks in Kinlock. So what they ended up doing is ended up suing and stripping Kinlock's tax base to create the Berkeley School District, right? Fast forward, you are now telling the Kinglock School District, right, where these kids can get up and walk to school because mama don't have a car, where these kids have built relationships with their teachers and the administrators because they live around the corner, that this school has to close, and now you have to merge with the Ferguson-Florissant School District, primarily white, because I deem you unconstitutional because you are all black, by no fault of your own. Imagine the very thing you hold dear, your school, your teachers, your sports, just the likeness of walking into a building and seeing people like you, learning about your own culture, right? Knowing those teachers actually care about you, right? That's taken away by no fault of your own. Clear out your lockers on Friday, get on the bus, this is where you're going on Monday, right? And this is during the 70s and how my dad would tell it, Roots came out at the same time, right? Roots came out. I tried to use a clip of Roots, but licensing and all the thing, I couldn't use it. But my dad would tell me, he's like, Alana, we fought all the time. I don't want to be here. I don't have a choice. I don't want to be here, right? So you're going in this place, and now you're second tier. So if you had a black superintendent over here, you think they're going to make him superintendent over there? No. They already have their school board. They already have their school board representation. They already have their higher ed administrators. They already have their teachers, right? They already have their school dances and their athletics and who they're going to put on the team. You got to fit into the fold by no fault of your own. So then things started to make sense to me as I started shaping the story, and just the power of narrative and how it has real world implications, specifically and primarily on marginalized populations, right? Again, thoughts, I don't deem you worthy enough to live next to, and beliefs, I'm gonna move. Not only am I gonna move, I have other people working with me. So I have mortgage lenders and real estate agents telling me that I can sell my house double the cost of what I paid for it because you're black, and I can get that money in return and go move somewhere else. Whole nother conversation, but that's essentially what happened, right? And drives behaviors, thus driving actions. The dissolution of the Kinglock School District, which actually made way for the airport to be able to come in and stake claim on those properties. How many parents do I have in the room? Right? And so I always use this as an example when it comes to, you know, what happened with Kinglock, and when there's no children in the area, what incentive do you have? I'm a mom, 14, 9 months. I'm not moving anywhere that doesn't have any promise. You don't have a school, you don't have commerce. What's incentive? I don't care how much I love this community. If there's no incentive for my descendants, there's no reason for me to live here, right? Thus, driving actions and where we see what Kinglock is like today. And so for people like, okay, I don't never live in Kinglock. I'm not from St. Louis, why should I care, right? Because it permeates in everything else, right? Story of Rosewood, Florida. This is a movie I've only watched one, I will never watch it again. But the story of Rosewood, Florida is how this massacre began. White woman was having an affair. The guy she was having an affair with was abusive, so she has marks on her body. And when her husband sees it, she claims that she was beaten by a black man that was released from prison. 400 dead bodies later. Now, how the movie depicts it at the very end, after they've murdered all of these people, their service workers, their nannies, the stores that they worked at, they decimated this whole land, right, this whole area, and the people who were doing the killing at the end of it goes to the girl's husband. It's like, you know your wife be cheating on you. Y'all knew that she was lying, and you allowed that lie to permeate the narrative that you kept up until this point, that you don't like us anyway, so I'm gonna use it as an excuse to decimate an entire city, right? Same thing again. As the story goes, he comes in, he whistles, he winks his eye, whatever he did not justify, right? The inhumane acts that was done to this little black boy and his family, who was then had to move, right, and the trauma that carried them for years, only for now her to be alive today to say, oh, I lied. What? The amount of hate crimes that happened after 9/11. From people who identified as Muslim, who were born on American soil, who had absolutely nothing to do with the atrocities of 9/11, right? But ended up being collateral damage because of the preconceived narratives that people carried, and they took it upon themselves to end somebody else's life. This young man was radicalized through the murder of Trayvon Martin and the murder of Freddie Gray. And in his mind, because of the riots and the protests, Black people are taking over. I don't like that. So I'm going to go into a church house. Almost changed my mind because they were being so nice to me, but because of my preconceived notions and narratives that I've carried up until this point, right, I'm going to take their life. Narratives are so dangerous when put into the wrong hands, right? But because I don't like ending stuff on a somber note, y'all, like, I like to keep my heart posture towards positivity. I say, we don't live in a bad world. There's bad people in this world. I will never allow the acts of this world to make me feel like we won't live in a better place. So my heart's posture is always going to be towards the betterment of people, always. But powerful narratives also send people to college. Powerful narratives also pay for people college, full ride scholarships, right? Write this essay. Give me some money, right? It also creates bonds between generations. Another reason why I made this film was because I felt like so many people, there's such a huge disconnect between the older generation and what they said, my generation. Y'all know no better. Y'all know no better. Y'all doing too much. And I'm like, who raised us? Right? But at the end of the day, it is important. And I wish every single, and I know she was with me. I know my grandparents were with me in making this film, but there's so many questions I wish I could ask the elders in my family now that I'm at the headspace that I am now. And that's why this film was so meant so much to me. So in the film, you saw me with the older people, and they presented me with a certificate because I helped put together the Kinlock Forever Festival. That had nothing to do with the film, but I want to do something more than a film. And I went with them, and these are former residents, 70, 80 years old, and we're planning this committee outside of a nursing home on Jenner Station Road. And we met there once a week. They would come outside from their rooms. We would meet in the community room. We would sit down, and I had my oldest daughter with me, and we planned this festival. And it worked out. They had another one this past year. They hadn't had one since 2018, and they're doing one again next year. So I'm super, super grateful. But, like, driving conversations. Like, for me, I wanted to know, like, my grandfather came from Covington, Tennessee. Well, how did you get to Kinlock? What brought you here? I learned my grandfather had a thing for white women. Covington, Tennessee, they told him, if we see you with another white woman, we're going to kill you. So he moseys on up. And clearly found somebody almost just as white. My grandmother's biracial. I didn't know that. My grandfather died when I was 9. I didn't know that. And so now it's like, I wish I could just sit at my grandparents' feet and just learn. Like, how did you get here? Like, what was that like for you? Like I said, I live in Dallas now. I had the comfort of planning my move, packing my stuff, getting a job that paid for my relocation. My grandfather got threatened to come up to St. Louis, right? That mindset, that shift, right? And all of the work that him and my grandmother put in to raise their children, my father included, to be able to do the work that I'm doing today, right? Depending on where you fall, narratives create bestsellers. Hey, I'm here for it, okay? Amazing book, but creates bestsellers, right? You get a peek inside of their world, and you get to resonate with their stories. Actually, Will Smith's book was one of the best books I've ever read in my life. Read the audible version. Amazing, right? Narratives also gives the opportunity for a young Black girl from St. Louis, a first-time filmmaker, to raise $25,000 in 3 weeks. To finish the film that you just watched. I use the power of story. And even for people, again, who know nothing about Kinlock, who are not in the city of St. Louis, who will never see this community, I want to support you because I care about what you're doing. I rock with what you're doing. So I'm going to give you this money because I believe in what you're doing. See, the power of narrative in the right hands can do amazing work, right? I just click on it. And it goes, I want to show a little clip about what I'm getting at and why this is so important.
So remember, the narrative paradigm operates not on logic, but on instinct, okay? So back to Fisher for a moment. The operative principle of narrative rationality is identification rather than deliberation. Okay? Remember how I said facts make more sense when they're presented as a story? Well, when facts are presented in a story that is familiar to us, we're very likely to accept it on gut instinct without ever examining it critically. So I said I was here to talk about stories, but what I'm really here to do is to ask you to do something. And that is to be deliberate, okay? I'm asking you to examine those narratives that you're presented with every day. Ask yourself, who's framing this story? Ask yourself, what are they selling you? And I don't just mean products, I mean values and beliefs. I want you to ask yourself that, am I just reflexively accepting that narrative that tells me I have to be prettier, thinner, richer? Am I just unconsciously accepting the story that tells me that that immigrant, that refugee, that person of color, that fill in the blank is a threat to my safety and security? Remember, stories are not just what we read in books and we see in movies and we tell each other over a glass of wine on Friday night. Stories really do shape our worldview, and we cannot let them do so uncritically.
So in practice, I like to give people homework. This don't cost you no money. Cost you a little bit of time, a little bit of interest. So how you can make a change in your tiny corner of the world. I know with everything that's going on in the world, the newsflash, there's always something going on in the world, right? But with everything going on in the world, it may feel very daunting and what power do I have, right? What can little old me do? And how I like to define the work that I'm doing, this social worker that's trying to be Ava DuVernay, I consider myself a pebble. And what happens when you throw a pebble into a river, a lake, or an ocean? I don't want to change the world. I want to impact the little world that I have. Because I know I will touch somebody and then they're going to go to their corner of the world. It's going to touch somebody and make their corner of the world. And that's enough for me. But first and foremost, inquire. Get inquisitive. Start asking questions. Stop taking things at face value, right? Second, challenge. Question and challenge everything you hear or that you learn. Like I said, my time at the Brown School as a 25-year-old adult living in St. Louis all my life, and I feel like I'm just learning things for the first time, which actually that's what you're supposed to do. I always want to be in a position to where I'm always learning. Not being lied to, but learning, right? Question not with a posture of defensiveness, but inquisitiveness, because there's always something to learn. Right? Let critical thinking drive you to truth. Let critical thinking move beyond your bias. Correct and check. Correct the narratives that you held onto that have now been proven untrue. See, the thing about narratives oftentimes, why it's so visceral, because we've tied those narratives to our identities. And then correcting those around you that also hold on to those narratives. Everybody want to come to our cookout. No, ain't no more room left, right? Not invited to the cookout. Not being mean, go to your cookout and have those conversations at your cookout. Those are where the conversations need to happen, right? Check those who hold on to those narratives that have been proven untrue. And resolve, right? Honestly, something as simple as a mere acknowledgement. You know how much things could be solved at this very moment if somebody just said, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that happened to you, Black people. What this country did to you, is continuing to do to you, is horrible. What we've done in the past is wrong. I'm sorry. Whew. Doesn't solve everything, but the fact that somebody can acknowledge it, that I'm not talking on deaf ears, that I'm not just spinning in circles, that I'm not going crazy, right? That I'm not a victim. This actually happened, it continues to happen. If you just, how many things could be resolved or at least put on an even playing field if somebody just acknowledged the pain, the hurt that has gone on for centuries and said, I was sorry. But in your corner of the world, just rectifying and acknowledging that these are real things that are happening to people, even if it's never happened to you, right? Doesn't cost you any money, just cost you some time. Ultimately, empathy is about replacing judgment with curiosity. We all have judgments, we all have biases, that's never going to change. But if you can have enough self-awareness to check it as it's happening and just get inquisitive, I just wanna know a little bit more. I didn't know that, right? Leading with empathy, again, doesn't cost you any money, just cost you some time. That's all I got for y'all. Thank you. Huh? Where do I go from here? That's a loaded question. What you mean? So tomorrow I'm on a plane, but that ain't what you meant. In a general sense, where do we go from here? Like, just, I would honestly say, take the time to digest what you've learned. We come into these spaces and it just can get so heady and academic-y, but these are real issues. Like, this is real people. I don't care how many degrees, and that's why when they told me I was gonna be in this room and then they're, you know, send me your bio on your head, I hate that. Like, just talk to me. Just have a conversation with me. I have degrees. I walked across the stage. I'm a first gen college student, went to WashU, all of those things, but just talk to me. Have a conversation with me. Learn a little bit about me. I tell people all the time, like, don't ask me how I'm doing unless you really wanna know how I'm doing. Cause I'ma tell you, you don't got the space, these my holding space hands. So when people's like, Alana, you got time? I'm like, I'm holding space for you. Yes, ma'am.
I have a Kinlock story.
I wanna hear it.
When I was 12 years old, I was a member of a drum and bugle corps called the Memorial Lancers.
Ooh.
And Mr. Frank.
Oh, can we get a, you wanna come up? I mean, I got one on me. Can you stand?
Yeah. Maybe if I come a little closer to come
and enunciate.
Okay.
Oh, you know my little bones.
I have a Kinlock story.
Mm-hmm.
When I was 12 years old, I was the member of a drum and bugle corps called the Memorial Lancers.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Frank Harrell was from Kinlock. And he had one of the raggediest buses, but where I live, we would walk to Forest Park and get on the bus, and then he would make sure we got home. And on occasion, we would go out to Kinlock, and it was just like one big village. The doors were open, everybody knew everybody.
Yep.
You just kind of walked down the street, you were safe.
Thank you.
And it was really a privilege, because with that relationship with a citizen of Kinlock, I was able to see pretty much all of the United States, because in our competition, we went to Philadelphia, to Miami, to Chicago, little towns in Tennessee, Murfreesboro, and we marched. And I was so excited when I saw that you had done this project, because with We Power, we did a tour of Kinlock.
Yeah.
And to see it now, tires and mattresses and furniture, and I remember at 12, it was so warm, it was so supportive. So thank you for what you've done.
Thank you. Hold on to that. If anybody, I'm open for questions. If anybody got questions, you can give them the mic. Thank you for sharing that though. I love hearing stories like that. I want to hear this.
As someone who likes stories,
mm-hmm.
And has somehow been deemed a storyteller, I think I'm just a listener and providing space. So I love that you said empathy, right? That is, for me, the core.
Mm-hmm.
I just empathize with people's situations. But I say, as a story, in the space of storytelling, how do you... when you're talking about the misuse, because I feel like storytelling has become a buzzword, and people are using that not to necessarily shift the narrative, but to prove that they are making impact in communities. So now community is getting hip to me telling you my story is just for you to get more funding. How do we, yes, yes, we will take a picture. Come tell your story, we wanna listen. How do we get actionable actions off of the storytelling?
Yeah.
That's my question.
Okay. That's loaded. That's loaded. So I would say, personally, from my experience in making this film, right, I talked about how long it took me to ever break out a camera and to build trust, but you also saw me in the film. I was the very last interview in making this film. I broke out a camera in April of 2016. I didn't film myself until December of 2020. Because I negated it the entire time. I was like, this ain't about me. Like, my sole position here is just to put the pieces together. Sit, create spaces for people to talk, share their insight, piece it together as I'm just learning, right? My role in this is to be the filmmaker. And I would show it to people and they're, you know, like there's something missing. Like, people wanna know the why. Like, why should people care about this story? And I, 3 years, this ain't about, I don't want to, like, I don't, this isn't, and even shaping it through, I was like, I can serve as a narrator to kind of weave it through and thread it through. But honestly, I would say positioning yourself to put other people in that place. So the people who belong there, right? The community members who belong there. I tell people all the time, I'm not from Kinlock. I'm not from there, right? My kinfolk is from there, I am not from there. But whatever I can do to help bring your stories to the forefront of the people who belong there. And I think in if I'm answering your question, right, I think, like you said, the community is now getting hip to it, like checking it when you see it. Because people always, I can already call it. You don't have to check me that I'm not from Kinlock. I told you I was not from Kinlock, right? That's not something that I claim, right? And so when it comes to raising money for a film or raising money for the community, like, what do you need me to do? Right. I have, I use an example of, like, I was talking to my therapist and it was a time that I had got a job and it was like my first six-figure job. And I was telling my therapist, I was like, I want to fly my parents down here and I want them to travel. And my parents are retired and we're all away and I want them to do this. And I want them. And my therapist was like, how do you even know that's what they want? You want that for them. It sounds nice. How do you know that's what they want? And so when we come into these cities, and when we go into North St. Louis and Kinlocks and Wellstons and Pagedales and Normandies, and it looks a mess, right? I want to go in. How do you know that's what they want? What do they want? Have you asked them what they want? And so for me, in creating this film, I was very meticulous, right? Because it very well could not have happened. But I wanted to make sure that I spoke with the people who could speak to their own experiences. Right, and even doing the festival, meeting with the Kinlock Reunion Committee, because this is something that they were already doing. Is this something I want to do? What do you need me to do? And so I think that's answering your question, not answering your question, but ultimately, like, putting the people in position to them empower themselves. I didn't empower these people, they already have power. I just use my role as somebody who's interested in filmmaking, right? I tell people all the time, I am a social worker. When you go to class, what do teachers use to inform your lecture? Textbooks and audiobooks and documentaries. This is my social work. All right. Did I answer your question? Because, you know, yes. I'll be on a tangent. But yeah, that's, yes.
Yes, I agree. Putting them in this position. Thank you for that.
Thank you. Rakita, you get my good side?
Hey, Alana girl, I'm so happy to be here and see the film. So my question slash comment slash just coming as my mouth is going, when we think about storytelling, it's nothing new. It has been with us since the dawn of the days and forever. And culturally for so long, they've tried to erase our stories. Mm-hmm. They've literally changed history books. Florida is Florida-ing, whatever they're doing. Mm-hmm. But for my family, I know stories have always been passed down from generation to generation because it is orally told to us. This is something that we know. But now we're transitioning into this world where we're surrounded by social media. And I know you are very active on social media and really good at it. So can you tell me more about how social media has been both a pro and maybe a con for storytelling?
Yeah, I think what really opened my eyes to the power of social media, because I'm also a social media manager, was Ferguson, And I remember it like it was yesterday, August 9th. My grandmother had just passed in June of 2014, and she lived, the grandmother that lived in Kinlock, they bought a house in Ferguson behind January Wabash. We're at her house, me, my mother, and my aunt, God rest her soul. My other aunt had just passed away 3 days prior. So my grandmother and my aunt passed away 2 months apart. So we're at the house, we're cleaning out the house in Ferguson, and I remember a note on my phone, like, heavy police presence in Ferguson. And then I'm clicking on it, and then I'm on Twitter, and they're like, Canfield. And I'm like, that's an exit away, right? Canfield Green, my cousins used to stay there. My oldest daughter, her father lives in North Wind Estates at the time. So I'm like, this is an area that I'm always at. So like, what's going on? And I remember we get in the car, we're driving. At the time, West Florissant was cut off. So I think we parked behind like Toys R Us or something in the neighborhood, and we're walking down, and it was before, like, his body was still laying on the ground, and I'm just seeing all of these people coming up, and they got the tactic tanks and the dogs, and just before it got really, really big, right? And so, of course, we found out what happened, and I'm just kind of watching how the media is playing it. So I can go home, and I'm watching it on the news, but I'm going, and I'm like, but that's not what happened, right? You got all of these national news outlets parked, and I'm watching it on the TV, but I can also get in my car, and I can see it, and I can talk to people that I know who have boots on the ground. I'm like, but that's not what's going on, right? And so that part, I thank God for Twitter during that time. During that time, because that's what really was the catalyst in learning about what is truly happening in our marginalized communities when it comes to getting murdered by the state. And as y'all saw, it shifted the whole world. So I thank God for social media in that regard. I thank God for social media and helping me, like, it was social media that drove this film. I use social media to my advantage to connect with people who never met me in person, but they're just interested in storytelling and protecting marginalized neighborhoods, and they found me through social media, right? Social media also helped me. I was diagnosed with ulcerative colitis in 2021, and that's another reason why personally storytelling is important. Elders, y'all need to start talking to y'all family members, right? How they passed? Oh, she was sick. What happened, right? No, I want to know. So it wasn't until I got diagnosed with ulcerative colitis that I learned that my aunt that passed away 2 months after my grandmother, she had it in the 90s. She ended up passing away from colon cancer. So I have two aunts that passed away from colon cancer. So now I'm on double watch, like, talk, right? It's a matter of life and death, right? And so going on Facebook and finding Facebook groups of also people who had ulcerative colitis. Again, my aunt's passed away. I can't talk to her. Like, nobody else in my circle had it. It helped me not feel so isolated. I don't like Facebook, but I loved it for that, right? My nine-month-old, she's an IVF baby. And connecting with other Black women specifically, because we don't talk about it. And connecting with people on social media who I don't know from Adam, but I felt supported. Like, social media, when done right, when put in the right hands, and when done with intention, can really shape a world. It just move mountains, right? And on the flip side, you see what happens when you have these headlines. Jada Pinkett Smith. Y'all talking, dang, y'all ain't even reading the book. You're not reading the book. You're taking one-liners, and they know that. They know. So if you're aware of that, let me check myself. Let me check my bias. Let me actually go and watch the whole 20-minute clip, right? Let me go and read the 300-page book, right? And so it's you having to be intentional and seeing, it's 2023, y'all. Like, we know clickbait. We know what this is. We know the type of outlets there are. We know that there's few, you know, major conglomerates that controls all of these networks. Like, be intentional with your education outside of the classroom, social media included. Thank you for asking. That's so great.
Thank you. I am a communications director for a nonprofit, so literally my job is to storytell. Mm-hmm. The question that I have for you, and specifically when we talk about nonprofit culture, is how do communicators in that position to hunt for stories that support, like, mission moments, how do we toe that line of not being exploiting people? Specifically, like when we talk about nonprofits potentially compensating people for their stories, or some people have feelings where, you know, some people say that it's a practice that you should do, and others say that it's not.
Yeah.
So I'm like trying to learn a little bit more of how to ethically promote people's stories that don't necessarily self-serve us.
Mm-hmm.
That's because we focus on LGBTQ plus rights. So elevating the voices that are missing from the narrative, specifically trans voices, trans women of color, that are missing from that media narrative so that the general public can hear from them, because those stories are so dramatically missing from this space.
Mm-hmm. That's, to be honest, that is extremely hard. That is extremely hard. Prior to creating this film, I hope you all got a chance to get the book and read the book. I was a storyteller for Humans of St. Louis. That's actually how I got trained in photography. The founder, Lindy Drew, trained me in photography before I got into documentary filmmaking, and she taught me the art of interviewing and storytelling and connecting with people around the St. Louis region and crossing places that I wouldn't have otherwise, right? But many people could probably say, or will want to say, right, that's exploitative. Even though it's doing amazing work, even though it's, I remember the story about one man who got his dental services paid for just from having his story highlighted on Humans of St. Louis. People who are no longer homeless, people got their children scholarships or what have you, right? Really, somebody is always going to have a problem with your practice, flat out. You're doing it for the money, you're doing this for the tax return, like, if that is an incentive and the work is still getting done and I'm leading with pure hearts, I don't have time to fight with you, but I don't have time to fight with you because I'm too busy doing the work. So when it comes to elevating marginalized populations, right, or the people who don't get that platform, make that a center practice, right? And so also getting another pair of eyes on that story. So I had to learn, like, interviewing is a practice, it is an art, right? Because you can also lean in with bias with your questions. I interviewed my dad 4 times. Getting interviewed is also an art and a practice. But I interviewed from him 4 times because I had to learn the type of questions to ask and how am I leading this and how am I leading you to respond. So having another person maybe in that population doing the interviewing, right, it makes that other person more comfortable, they have more awareness, right? And so setting the tone and setting the atmosphere in order for that person, whoever story you want to highlight, and having another pair of eyes to make sure, like, that's their story getting elevated outside of whatever job you're doing, whatever grant application that you are submitting. It's a hard line to toe. So I just say lead with pure intention, because you're always going to get, at the end of the day, somebody else going to claim you're doing it for the money. You're doing it for the money. You're doing it for this reason. It's hard. But elevating those voices and centering other people to be at the forefront of elevating those voices. Like, sometimes I brought in another lady to help me interview some of the former residents. Because I'm like, I want it to be conversational. Only you can bring that out of that person because you can relate. I can't relate. What I can do is press record. So I'll sit back. I'm going to let y'all talk and I'm going to capture it. I'm going to get your permission. Do I have your consent? Another thing that I did in making the film before finishing, I did a private screening with former residents, and I had them watch it. Is this accurate? Am I depicting this the way that it, despite how you feel, right? But is this accurate, right? Does this make sense? Like, before I show it to the world, and so I made sure I prioritize their insights and their experience and their wisdom before bringing it to you all. I hope to help a little bit, y'all. I don't have all the answers. I just know a little bit. I don't got the answers, Sway. Any other questions, my good people? If not, it has been a pleasure. I was so nervous, y'all. I was so nervous. Yeah. I was so nervous. Thank you for holding space. Again, I flew in just for this. And I always like to keep a toe in St. Louis and the work that you all are doing. And I'm St. Louis to the death through and through. It is an amazing city. a beautiful city, a city with so much potential. I wish we would move out of the state of potential. I don't know how much longer we gonna stay in potential. I don't know how long we gonna stay in potential. But y'all are doing amazing work, and even if it feels like you're not doing amazing work, you are doing amazing work. You are impacting people every single day. Be proud of yourself. Give yourself grace. Give yourself rest. And yeah, enjoy the rest of your amazing, amazing weekend, and thank you for your time.